access to nature. Studies have shown people that are in a hospital that have a view of grass or of trees or of water actually heals much faster. We do know that there are benefits to the actual system just being able to go out and look at water. The quality of your life increases exponentially with having access to fresh water. So for a person of color, like being born in a brown body, you're already being born in a stressed environment. So you take a space that is accessible. Now, just because we don't use it how other people think we should use it does not mean that we are not using it, right? Like, we may not bird, but we may walk through it. We may not walk through it, but we like to sit and look at it. We also have to acknowledge that people in Chicago are allowed to interact with nature however they wish. And as a Black community, I also wear different identities. I have my spirituality, I have my motherhood, so I might interact with nature with my children. There's also the different able-bodied community, and realizing that maybe people are not using it in a certain way in a certain area because they cannot. So we also have to reflect on how it is that these natural areas are meant to serve certain communities. And if we want them to have health benefits, how is it that we're promoting it? What organizations are around that can help facilitate that dialogue and accessibility? Are there any other questions?
You know what the proposal, removing the nature sanctuary and the golf course, would that be inside the new golf course?
So my name is Susanna Ripstein. I am one of the volunteer co-stewards for the Nature Sanctuary. We have a volunteer stewardship program there. We have for the past 2 years. Every month, folks come out, they pick up trash and pull weeds, but also just hang out and enjoy it any way that people want to. So I've been paying attention to this question. The plans that they have come up with are online, you can look at them, but as I understand it, I don't speak for the Park District, I don't speak for the Chicago Parks Golf Alliance, but my understanding from going to all of the meetings and looking at all of the plans is that what they're proposing, the replacement natural area would be possibly a strip along the lake, and also an area that would be between two fairways, sort of right along the cultural center. When it was suggested to them that maybe that area could be used for an additional fairway to leave the nature sanctuary where it is, they said it wouldn't be safe for an additional fairway because it's too close to the other fairways, which begs the question, how is it safe for a nature sanctuary? So that is my understanding.
Would it be publicly accessible?
Theoretically, but it's in an island in the middle of the Gulf fairways, so. I think they drew a little path that would go between the fairways, but I don't understand how it would be open and accessible.
It's also uncertain how this, how the physical plan is going to address some of the other issues that we're dealing with in Chicago and the shoreline. So thinking about the rising levels of Lake Michigan, thinking about areas that flood, how sustainable and green is this actual plan? Now, Chicago does have the greenest harbor in the world, and that's 31st Street Harbor, and that's something to brag about. So is it of the mind of developers, Tiger Woods Group, as well as the city, to say, if you want to do this here, it needs to be as sustainable as possible. We want biodegradable golf balls. We want all organic use of fertilizers or management practices. What is it that they're promoting that would make this something that Chicago can boast and brag on and doesn't create much more of an issue or work in conflict with what it is that we put in our climate action plan? That's my other question for how it is that these natural green infrastructure projects or restoration projects that look to create economic development opportunities are filtered through what it is we've already put in place, whether it's our biodiversity plan, our climate action plan, or our disaster plan. How does it fit within the context of what it is Chicago is trying to accomplish by 2050? Were there any other questions?
I just wanted to add one dimension. I couldn't think of the studies, but the studies are done by Dr. Carl Bell. I want to put that into people's mind and understanding, because he's done tremendous work in talking about the stress the physical, mental, emotional stress in the Black community and the connection between de-stressing, meaning that feeding lower blood pressure and lower mental breakdowns and depression as a result of having access to nature. And so part of what we're talking about here is this whole strip of golf courses. It starts at 57th Street, goes all the way to 71st, from the lake to Lake Park, Stony Island. You're talking about stripping away access to the kind of sanctuary that we have been able to use for our recreation and our ability. So nature sanctuary is just one part of that whole piece. We need to look at it in that context, and we need to read Dr. Carl Bell.
So to your point, look at the percentage of renters and owners and access to actual space that people go out and recreate. Usually people don't have a backyard, so we do use our parks. So for people who don't understand what she's expressing, the reality of what is the internal state of a Black or brown body? Your heart is beating faster, or the internal stress of your body is causing you to deteriorate faster. There's no getting around it. I am 7 to 10 years older internally in comparison to a white woman my same age. 7 to 10 years older internally. So what she's expressing is having access or an opportunity to engage in a landscape that allows me to learn how to de-escalate is a benefit to me. Considering we are 100 years after the race riots, where Black and brown people were being chased out of natural areas, we're right back at the shores trying to advocate to retain access to a natural area. And I don't want people to forget, we had to fight for access to be on our lakefront.
Amen.
They created an invisible line of where we shouldn't float over. It's a reason why you don't see a lot of Black lifeguards or a lot of black captains. It's a reason why you don't see a lot of captains of vessels on Lake Michigan. It's a reason why you don't see a lot of African-American fishermen in certain areas. It's a reason why you don't see a lot of Black swimmers. It's a reason why you don't see a lot of Black ecologists. Every single aspect of the environment has been withheld from us. We were not allowed to be part of our honor society. We were not allowed to be Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts. We were not allowed to, you know, play basketball in areas of Chicago. And honestly, there are communities where Black people still would not be outdoors. In an Illinois state park, a Black child was attempted to be drowned by a white family just 2 or 3 years ago. You don't belong here. Just what, 2 summers ago, was a white woman harassing a Black woman on Oak Street Beach, calling them niggas on Oak Street Beach 2 years ago. So now we are here, and our elected officials, one, don't understand the history of environmentalism and urban and people of color. We don't even honor environmental justice and people for community recovery that's still fighting on the front lines of the toxic donut. We've forgotten about Hazel Johnson and that they're still fighting. So while we're here talking about the monarch and talking about trying to retain access to this one area, this is just reflective of a practice of legal land grabbing that has been going on. We've lost 13% of the population of African Americans for the first time. We're now in the South Suburbs. So as we talk about the benefits of nature and how it is that nature has become more equitable, one has to look at the numbers. It's easy to talk about how you handle poverty.
My name is Ann Holcomb. I'm with Ethos, and we started as a block club in South Shore back in 2014, and we've now grown to 90 members in 6 wards to try to fight this. And one of the reasons I got involved, and I want to speak very personally, is I'm a manager of a homeless shelter, and it's the only homeless youth shelter on the south side of Chicago. It's called Ujima Village. It's in Greater Englewood. And every year, we don't have a van, we don't have a bus, none of that. So every year, whenever I take the youth anywhere for a speaking engagement or to an appointment or whatever, I try to come here some point during the day. So I have a carload full of young men, most of whom have never seen the lake, and I take them to the nature sanctuary. And if they're not feeling it, we're in and out of there in 10 minutes. If they're feeling it, we linger for an hour or two, right? And so it is just so important to back, and I've read Dr. Carl Bell, I've read other studies. Nature therapy is today what art therapy was about 10 years ago. And wouldn't it be awesome if we had a nature therapy center in the South Shore Cultural Center right here, so that we could help people and stop some of this violence and actually use this area to help people, right? And then on top of that, the people don't know this here. I worked for, when I was getting my master's degree, I worked for Ancona School in Hyde Park. And this was just getting constructed, but they knew nothing about it, right? And the thing is, we packed all the school children for field trips on a bus 2 hours to the Little Red Schoolhouse in the suburbs, right? When you're talking about getting kids on and off the bus, it takes forever, right? What about if they don't spend that time on the bus? What if they spend it in nature right here? And we have a natural interpretive center here all the time in South Shore Cultural Center. Let's return the cultural center to the people, push the park district offices out, to push out the cultural organizations and the arts organizations that used to be here, and return it to what we saved it for.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Naomi Davis of Blacks in Green, and I want to say that yes to all of the environmental benefits of keeping the habitat and investing more in the habitat. And furthermore, has a compelling case been made to displace it? What is the return on the investment to Southside taxpayers? What is the parity in what's being spent in other parts of Chicago versus what's being spent on the South Lakefront? So if you compare city expenditures, North Lakefront versus South Lakefront, you'll see almost an apartheid type financial scenario. And so we have not heard the numbers, the case made by the Tiger Woods golf course or any other kind of expansion of the golf course that would make a case for an economic return on the investment of the taxpayers of this place, let alone equity, let alone parity. Who are the beneficiaries going to be? And I'm sorry, caddy jobs are not enough justification for.
Hi, my name is Robin
Kaufman,
and I live in Chicago. Diet Park Advisory Council. Diet Park is there was a Park District field house in Washington Park. It was joint with the Board of Education. The Board of Education was responsible for the maintenance. Guess what? The Board of Education decided they needed their money for education, and they stopped maintaining the pool. And we used to have a lot of lifeguards changing the lifeguarding program at Diet Pool. But then the park district, they said, well, black folks swim. And gradually, we lost the use of the pool. One of my fears here, and we have to guard against it, hopefully, this golf thing won't go through. If it does go through and they give us a little patch here, a little patch there, what's to stop them 10 years down the line from saying, oh, well, this isn't safe, or we don't have the money to maintain it, whatever they say. How can we proceed with this? The community fought for this. So we got to protect this now.
It is so important that we acknowledge that we can have both. We can have economic development and we can have health. Absolutely. There's no reason that Chicago is a global city and one of the most, top 10 segregated cities and one of the wealthiest cities, because I think water as well, is making decisions on using its natural areas through investments that, in my opinion, are unwise, considering the unknowns that climate change presents us. Everything that we do with our natural areas needs to be filtered through an equity lens, because there is a need to do some reparations for how it is that urban blacks are treated and continue to be treated across the nation. Chicago also has an opportunity to lead the charge and show other cities. We have a responsibility to the smaller suburbs that are 80 and 90% African American, where we're being moved to and there are water shut off, to create paths understand, we don't need more colleges. We just need everybody to understand ecology. So for our elected officials, it makes no sense that you don't understand water in our combined sewer system. It makes no sense that you don't understand that we have over 10,000 dying ash trees and then opportunity for us to cover our green infrastructure in flood. There's no reason that you shouldn't understand about green infrastructure in asthma. There is no reason that you shouldn't understand waste and cannabis. There's no excuse at this point. There's no excuse for any black elected official to say that a living system that has been cared for over 20 years by people who are brown, black, and everything in between, to claim that it is dead. And just because you don't see it does not mean it is not there. And I challenge every elected official around the area to come back here. Bring your family. Come out here on a Sunday. There are weddings. There are parties. Come out and enjoy the beach and the water. Take your family back there on a walk. The fact that we don't engage in nature but then make decisions about it is going to be to the detriment of the black community. And that is an invitation. That is an invitation to reach out to the environmentalists of color. Because it is important that when we sit at the table and we talk about economic investments, and whether it's cannabis or an urban garden, that we are informed, that we are connected to the best research, that we are talking to Chicago State University, that we are talking to UIC and Public Health and COPPA, that we are talking to University of Chicago and creating pipelines and answers that translate into policies and strategies that prioritize